Okay, so now we are going to discuss the architecture of MapReduce, and we will understand MapReduce from logical point of view as well as from physical point of view. So we will be doing side by side comparison, like how it is working, and this will give you clarity, like overall how other distributed processing frameworks work. So there are some differences among different distributed frameworks, but the idea behind MapReduce is a kind of core to lot of distributed processing frameworks. So that's why I wanted to cover the high level architecture of MapReduce. So let's start with this. This is MapReduce architecture. So before we go inside the architecture, just understand there are some responsibilities of mapper and there are some responsibilities of reducer. So mapper responsibility is to extract data, filter data, parse data, and transform the data. Reducer responsibility is to apply statistical functions. Statistical functions like aggregations and other things. So these are high level responsibilities of map and reduce. So now let's see the architecture, how does it look like, and we will start with logical architecture first and later on we move towards the physical architecture. So here I will have logical and here we will have physical architecture. So I'll be making use of the space and then I'll be drawing physical architecture here. So this is logical view. And this is physical view. Now in logical view, we find that we have, let's say, different stages in MapReduce. So let's say we have this and another stage is this and another stage is, so there are multiple stages here. Okay, so let's say this is our input data and this is our output data. So you know, like input data and output data both are stored in HDFS. This is in HDFS and this is also stored in HDFS. So why we are storing input data and output data in HDFS? Because we want the data should be there for the long term. So HDFS provides fault tolerance and horizontal scalability. So that's why we are storing our input data on HDFS and output data on HDFS. Now, if you see, like this is mapper phase, and this one is the local file system of mapper. This is local file system of mapper machine. This one is shuffle and sort phase. This is a phase. This particular thing is local file system of reducer machine. This particular phase is reducer phase. So if you see, like there are multiple stages here and each stage has certain role to play. So let's see the physical architecture. And in physical architecture, we will see like there are multiple machines. So this is my master machine and we will basically be having a lot of worker machines. So this is like one worker machine, another worker machine, another worker machine. So let's say we have another worker machine. So these are worker machines. So in master machine, let's say we have a daemon running and this daemon is called job tracker. So this is a daemon. This is one daemon running in the worker machine, another daemon running in the worker machine, another daemon running in the worker machine, and then we have a daemon running in the worker machine. So I will be showing this, like this is our JVM daemon. Yeah. So these daemons are called, this is called task tracker. and I am writing here TT. This is task tracker. This is task tracker. So there is another daemon running which is related to data node, and I am not showing this again, but I am just writing data node is also running in parallel to task tracker, which is a worker daemon of HDFS. Worker daemon of HDFS because MapReduce is running on top of HDFS. So if you see the architecture, the logical view, this is how MapReduce is and this is HDFS. So here we have HDFS and here we have MapReduce. And since MapReduce is running on top of HDFS, so that's this is logical view and this is physical view, like data node and task tracker, they are co-located. Yeah, to achieve data locality principle. So we want the processing should be scheduled as close to the data as much possible. Yeah, so this heartbeat is going to the master and master name is job tracker. And similarly, we have name node. I'm not showing name node here. And then I'm just writing NN and data nodes are reporting to name node. So right now, just see this heartbeat is going from this is heartbeat. Right. And this one is our JVM daemon. So I have indicated like this. So this is JVM daemon long running process. So let's start how it works. Let's say in HDFS, we already have input data. So I'm representing this input data here. So let's say we have data here. This is block one and this is block two. This is block three. I'm showing distinct blocks. I'm not showing the same blocks again, because if you have same blocks, then that is replication and replication is a concept of HDFS. So we are not discussing fault tolerance of storage here. So we are discussing the processing part. So how does it work actually? In case of MapReduce, basically you are reading data from HDFS and then it goes into mapper. So let's say we have this thing like the data is being moved from HDFS to mapper. Yeah, so this is a mapper phase and mapper is a JVM and we want to basically process data in mapper. So here I will write down the data. Let's say we have data and we are working on a problem called word count. So we are counting word count problem and it is hello world of distributed computing. But you know, like this seems to be very simple problem, but actually if you find like more than 70% of the problems related to big data are related to counting. If you see, if I want to find how many products were sold in last 6 months, or you want to find number of visitors on my website, so you will find word count is very common in lot of big data related problems. Apart from that, you will also see that word count is very powerful when it comes to doing capacity planning and understanding the details about the framework. So this is very interesting, very powerful problem to solve if we actually look into the depth of word count. For the time being, since we are doing crash course here, so just understand like how it is basically working. So let's say we have data. This data is in HDFS and this is big data. This is huge data. Let's say we have this data and I'm ignoring the punctuation when we are doing word count. So for the time being, just understand this is my data. And in mapper phase, it is responsible for extracting, filtering, parsing, transforming. So it will basically parse and then it will emit 1, 1, 1 along with each word. So we want to do counting. Counting will happen in the reducer phase. So here I am just doing this one is one, big one. So like that we have data one, and similarly we will have this one is one, huge one, data one. So this will be the output. This is intermediate data. This is intermediate data and this intermediate data will be on different mapper machines. So let's say this is my mapper machine. So I will be using now another color and I will be showing it with the help of these mappers. Let's say these mappers are created here. How they are created, you can watch the video of Yarn like how resource allocation is happening and how the application master comes into picture. So that is a separate discussion, because that is like resource allocation happening. But right now, just understand, we have these mapper JVMs running. So Yarn, if you watch Yarn architecture, then you will find that Yarn architecture and MapReduce architecture, they can work together. So you can see that particular video, and there you will find details about how this allocation of mappers are happening. But let's say we got the mapper somehow, and we are just showing this, like we have these mappers, and these mappers are represented like this. And I am showing these mappers here also, and I am representing this like this. So this is my JVM, and this is not a daemon. So this is JVM, normal JVM, it's not a daemon. So it's not long running, it is on demand. So let's say this is step number one, this is step number one, step number one, step number one. So this is mapper JVM, the JVMs are represented. So this is mapper one, mapper two, and this is mapper three. So these three mappers are running. So this is step number one, we are reading data from blocks to mapper. And then step number two is to store data, whatever intermediate data is generated, it will be stored on the mapper local file system. So this goes into mapper local file system. So can you see, like, this is local file system of mapper, and here it is storing. So you can assume this one is here, or this one is here, or this one is here. So maybe we have large data set, big data, and some part of this data is here, some part of this data is here in the form of blocks. And this particular data is in like orange color, so I will use the same color here. So this is orange color. So this data is basically stored on these machines, like local file system of mapper. And this color actually indicating that the data is actually stored here on the local file system, right? So the third step is to move data from mapper local file system to reducer local file system. So this is step number three, and we are moving data. I'm showing it like this, but it can happen on the same machine where mappers are running. So any machine can be reducer, but right now, just to make the things simpler, I'm moving data from mapper local file system to reducer local file system. So data moves here into the reducer machine. And after that, we have next step, which is reading data from local file system to reducer. So this is step number four. And step number four is to read data from local file system to reducer JVM. And where is the reducer JVM? So let's draw one reducer JVM here. So this is the reducer JVM. Here we are reading data from local file system of reducer to into reducer JVM. And then it is generating output in the form of, this is next step. And next step is to generate data into HDFS again. So let's say this is our step number five. And step number five is to generate data. So let's do it. So this is generating data output into HDFS again. So this is our HDFS, this output block. So output files and file will have multiple blocks. So this is output data. And in between, like if you see how this data looks like, so this data is actually grouped data. So this is again like in green color. So you can say this data is this 1, 1. So let's say we have 4 ones in the original text, and we have, let's say, 3 ones. So it is grouping. So shuffle and sort is responsible for grouping data, you can say. And we are able to group data together. So this is the final output, and final output is something like this 4 is 3, so like that. So this was basically high level overview about MapReduce, the concept behind MapReduce, and the similar concepts you will find in Spark also. This is how distributed processing is working. So ignore that it is job tracker or task tracker, but focus on how MapReduce is working, because that is the takeaway from this discussion. Apart from that, like you can also see, like we are generating data in local file system. So in local file system, like 75% of the space is for storing HDFS blocks, and 25% of the space is for local file system data, like the way we are storing here. So this is a configuration in HDFS to define like how much ratio we want to keep. So in case This intermediate data is much more than the disk space available. 25% of the disk space available on each worker machine, then your program will fail and you will get exception out of disk exception kind of things you will see in the logs. So be careful about it. When you are doing capacity planning, you have to consider, you have to think about this fact that are my mappers exploding data? Are my mappers generating more data than input data? And do we have sufficient capacity in each worker machine to hold that data? So you have to consider these factors when you are doing capacity planning. You have to work with your administrators as well as developers, and then ensure that the cluster is well prepared for these kind of issues. So hope you got some idea about this MapReduce architecture. And if you have any questions, you can always reach out. Let's now look into the YARN related stuff.